Barnsey Podcast, episode 8. What's the date today?
It is the 30th of November.
30th of November.
30 days has November.
We'd like to welcome to the podcast as usual, Brewer on the controls. And our new guest, Jezza B. Thanks for joining us today.
Pleasure, treasure.
It's been I think it was about the 9th of this month that we upped our last podcast. And just firstly, once again, like to say thanks to everyone that tuned in, downloaded it. We're getting heaps more plays on iTunes than we are getting on YouTube, which is, you know, the opposite way we thought it would go down. But it seems that it's easier for people probably to listen to, especially a longer podcast, like on iTunes and stuff like that. So, yeah, thanks for everyone for subscribing and stuff like that. So, this is the new podcast studio that we were talking about. We've kind of haphazardly set it up today because we've only just sort of gotten stuff in here. So, the usual Barnsey podcast style, fucking everything at the last minute.
That's cool, man. I dig it.
Setting up microphones and shit with the guests, hanging out, waiting. This is the new room. You can see the trippy wallpaper behind us. And, eventually we'll get this properly set up and it'll be the new regular Barnsey podcast lair. Welcome to the new digs. So I guess we'll just jump straight into it. What you been up to lately, Brewer? Any news from you?
Oh, you know, the standard stuff, everyone. Moving house, the joy of moving house.
Fucking sucks.
Still, you know, on the work hunt as well. So, you know, juggling that at the same time, you know, getting internet sorted in an old house.
Oh,
so,
man.
All that kind of stuff.
The new internet here has been a bit flaky. If this podcast doesn't go up until 2015, it's because our internet connection is fucking shit at the moment.
I think we've got it pretty much as good as we're going to get it, but...
It's doable. It's workable.
Yeah, but, yeah, it's not as good as what we had at Roselands, but, yeah. You know, it's a pretty big house and an old house, so you got to take some concessions, I guess.
Yeah, that's it, yeah. Jez V, thanks for coming into the podcast.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah, no worries.
Welcome. It's been a while. It's been a while, especially with the Brewer.
Yeah, man.
Caught up for
a fair few years, man.
Yeah. Revolutions, it seems.
I've been around. I'm sure you've been around doing a few things since then as well.
Well, what year was Same it that things. we were flatmates?
I would have been at school.
What year was the last River Road adventure?
97 to 98.
Was it that 97 to 98? It's so interesting me catching up with old friends because my chronology of that stuff is so scattered. Hey, like if you had to put down $100 on the table and ask me what years River Road was, I wouldn't have been able to tell you. Hey,
really?
Not for $1 million, I don't think.
Yeah, I would have said around 2000 era.
97, 98.
We got out of there 98, end of 90, towards the end of 98.
Have you ever driven past that area? Is that house still standing? I heard it.
Yeah, I put some shots on Facebook.
Yeah.
Jono Starling did as well.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, it's still there.
It's still there.
Yeah.
No way.
It's still there.
Still occupied. No, it's still.
It's probably had renos and shit. You'd think it'd have renos done.
Oh man, it was falling apart when you guys were there. Jesus Christ.
So, like I said on Facebook, it's like probably still occupied by tip rats.
That's 97, 98. That's a fucking, 15 years?
I remember that's when I first came back to Australia, and I remember you started recording and you'd jam your door shut and we'd have just leads like everywhere.
That's right.
Mattresses up on the door and like it'd just be so loud and mashing those drums.
That were the years basically after I'd done my School of Wood Engineering course, and that was, where I cut my teeth on all this stuff that I'd learned in engineering course with you and with Mitch, you know, just, setting up drums or, like, you know, recording vocals and guitars in this, you know, residential house. I remember, didn't we do the block rock and beats stuff?
We did.
Yeah.
And that's like, right.
Recorded the Simon doing the sample in my bedroom and... that was pretty cool. So that was like the formative years really of me, you know, getting some chops down for audio engineering and then being eventually able to start the studio Yeah, that was cool. It was like, you know, disposable musicians at my, you know, at my hands, you know, living with, you know,
hack shit up at River Road. Yeah, it was the other days.
No, pretty cool, man. Yeah.
I found some footage of that, actually.
Really?
But there was no sound. Yeah, there was footage of me doing a take for Block Rockin'. Well, I assume it was Block Rockin'.
No way.
Yeah, it was definitely it was on an old VHS.
Fucking hell. See, that's the thing. Like, today, it's like everything's captured. Like, there's pictures, there's video. Like, we can just grab, you know, our phone and get high def video and stuff. But like back in the 90s, man, like it was super rare to have, you know, even have your photo taken, you know? Like,
yeah.
I've got fuck all photos and video of that era.
It's a shame, isn't it?
You know, it's weird when I see somebody that's got something that I didn't realize they had, and you, especially video. Like there's this, a mate of mine used to go and do table tennis tournaments at his house, like back in the 90s. And he pulled out, like, he posted on Facebook some, crusty VHS version of it. And it's, like, it's so weird to see, you know, young version of yourself from, like, 15, 18, 20 years ago. You know, in your head, you kind of, you know, have I changed that much from that era? And then you look at actual footage from then, and like, man, I am so different from then. Like,
you still look 18, mate, come on.
Bless you, gorgeous self. In the stairwell. From when my mum got married the second time, and I can barely remember that. And I was the page boy, carrying the ring on the fucking. And I remember holding the pillow. I just remember holding the pillow. And I look at it, and it's like, holy fucking shit, man. Like, I was like a little kid.
So we were like, talking about Lord of the Rings before. You were like little Frodo, whatever his name is.
Like in bed praying for Aragorn and getting all happy when Gandalf comes around.
well, speaking of movies, we were also talking about the new Star Wars trailer that's just hit. Where did you see it? Did you see it online or did you see a movie recently? Because I know a few people have seen it actually in the theatres.
I saw it online. I thought it just came out yesterday or the night.
The first that I saw of it was actually somebody had leaked it and it looked like somebody with a mobile phone in a theatre. And this is only, 1 or 2 days
was
ago.
Was this Mitch Hertz's Rick Astley one?
Oh, no, I didn't. I'd rarely click on Mitch Hertz links to say because of said Rick Astley potential.
I fell for it.
No, I didn't. Well, this is my point. Like, I haven't watched the trailer yet. I've seen originally there was like leaked versions, and now it looks like there's official. You know, watch the official trailer online.
Well, I'm going to leak something right now.
Yeah.
You're about to watch it for the first time, and we're going to get your first impressions.
I think my laptop might have died, so I might do it on my phone. But yeah, the reason why I haven't watched it yet, firstly, is like we were saying before, I find it weird watching a trailer for a movie that's not due to come out for so long. Now, when is it going to drop? Is it? It's not even 2015.
It's not for ages.
It's 2016, isn't it?
18th of December.
18th of December 2015. Right.
Okay. Do you honestly get excited for a trailer? Are you like, oh, here we go. I'm like, it's just going to spoil it. Here we go when the movie comes out. And I hate watching these trailers because it just gives away way too
much. Well, I knew it would show fuck all. I'm giving away now. So right. We've got to wait.
I'm loading it up as we speak.
We've got to wait for the man to check it out. But what can I say? I'll tell you later.
Are you genuinely excited for a new Star Wars?
Well, what Star Wars fan is it? Let's admit it.
Yeah, look, I'm genuinely excited for a new Star Wars.
As much of a Star Wars fan you are, whether it's this much or this much, of course you're going to be interested in the very least in a new Star Wars franchise. Yeah. So let's just wait a bit longer and wait for some more trailers to tell us how shit it'll be. I mean, the Disney thing's a bit disturbing. This is the first one that I saw. I'll shut up now.
To be strong in the Force is one thing, but to believe oneself to be all-powerful is to invite catastrophe. Bidding my master.
This is what I've been waiting for. Let me fight.
You can never escape me.
Jedi, where is he?
I've finally drawn you out of hiding.
All these years, lost.
The Empire is reborn.
May the Force protect us all.
You guys got room in this battle for an old war?
Oh. Oh my god.
Seeing too much. Already.
What's that little noise at the end?
2015. Okay, so I think that's a good teaser trailer.
I'm not going to watch anymore.
You were screaming, seeing too much? I don't know. They had to give some tasty nuggets. They had to allow
there is another,
us to see some potential.
There's another one, is
there? There is another.
And I'm not going to watch anything else because that was enough to get me going.
Sure.
I want to fucking see that. And I'll forget it by that time next year. And then it'll be fresh again.
Okay, so I can see there's a couple
there's
of...
There's one that I think it's called the International... that was the International trailer. There's another one.
Yeah, I see that was the Force Awakens International teaser trailer. And there's just the Force Awakens teaser trailer, which is only 53 seconds long. And then there's one that says it's the Black Friday trailer. And it looks like it's got a screenshot of Han Solo.
Black Friday was just yesterday.
I think that was... Like, okay, so they had to show what they were going to do CGI-wise in some capacity in the trailer, you know? So I think
this is the other one.
Yeah, yeah. Do I want to see this?
Oh, no, this isn't it. Kill it.
No.
No.
Is this an official one though?
That was a bit...
Sorry about that. Anyway.
Yoda just like cracking an
immortal. If you really want to...
That's what it looked like. No, I love that first trailer we saw, I liked it.
Yeah, it was a good trailer.
I think that, they needed to display what they were going to do, potentially CGI-wise, and that was pretty tasty, that space scene that we saw there. Mm. Now, do you know much about the story, about where this movie's set in the timeline of it? They still were saying...
Apparently some black stormtrooper gets a lightsaber... That's all I can get out of it.
Because I heard them
say... And you see Luke a bit older, you know, a bit wiser, a bit Obi-Wan-ish.
Right, okay.
Obi-Wan-esque.
Because that's my question. When Lucas did the additional movies, they were prequels to the Star Wars timeline that we know. Are these after those main Star Wars timeline?
Yeah, they're 30 years later or 35 years later.
And it's where the Empire has been defeated, but now it's come back. That's what it sounded like they were alluding to in that trailer, is that the rise.
So many years lost.
Yeah. I don't know much. There's theories, but no, I don't think anyone knows the real direction of it yet. It hasn't really been leaked.
From that trailer, I got that they're kind of... It feels like Star Wars, like a proper Star Wars. You know, it's not like, you know, Disney-fied as people, you know. It's only a trailer. It's only a trailer, and we'll wait and see when the movie comes out.
Mm.
But that was a good trailer that genuinely makes me want to see the movie.
Yeah. Well, okay. Well, I got pretty much the same feeling, but, you know, the caution bells are ringing loud when you're watching...
A trailer.
A trailer that's, as you said, is a year off. A year and 3 weeks.
The gaming world, when you see some of these trailers, and it's like, oh my god, man, this looks like the best fucking thing ever. And then when you get to the final product 2 years later or whatever, you know, you're like, oh, this is so different to what I was building it up to be.
Yeah.
And it's the same thing with movies, you know, and they want to build it up because, you know, it generates that buzz and, obviously,
well, it's huge.
Makes you not download it and go and see it.
if there's something that's, you know, bankable, it's Star Wars. Like, that's just such a bankable thing. And I think that...
But it doesn't feel like it's a cash-in. Like, they're just using Star Wars. That one felt more like proper Star Wars than Phantom Menace.
Well, definitely. I agree with that.
But it's only a trailer.
Let's do the second trailer. I found it. You can do it on here.
Yeah.
Hopefully we won't get a silly ad for God knows what.
Which one was it?
The one with the... Yeah, him. You got a brewer? I think I prefer that one.
That's a better trailer. That's more
that's a pretty fucking good trailer.
Gets you thinking.
There's obviously Millennium Falcon, so there's that. And I think there were some like shots released online of like JJ Abrams on set. You know, they've released these key photos along the way to sort of as a few clues. And I think one of them was that the Millennium Falcon on set with JJ Abrams. So. And there you go, it's obviously being used. So what does that mean? Do we get old Han Solo?
JJ Abrams, well...
You know, and you said 30 years set in the future. That's about how old the actors from...
It is, yeah.
From that Star Wars
franchise. I reckon franchise they'll be in for like, you know, 5-10 minutes and then hand over to the next year.
They all look older than that, but they all had their own personal trainers and
nutritionists. Yeah, and it's amazing what you can do with CGI. Have you seen... Tron,
the new one. No, I haven't. It's not a remake.
Well, no, not really.
It's a reinventing.
Yeah.
Well, it's rebooted, but it is a sequel because isn't it about the sun? I haven't seen it.
It is. You're right, actually, because they have Jeff Bridges' character in it. Who was in the original, and they CGI him to look that same age, and it's pretty freakish, man. Like, it's not quite 100% believable. But like the scenes where they make him try to look like the same age as he was in the original Tron, it's pretty full on. Like,
I think I saw Tron at the old Chatswood cinema.
No way.
1981 or whatever.
No way. Yeah. Full on.
Yeah.
Original Tron.
I think it was there.
Fucking quality movie. And I love the remake. I saw it at the IMAX in 3D, and that was fucking epic because the whole thing's a CGI film. Or when you go into the Tron world, it's a full CGI. Mm. Environment, the 3D is just fucking impeccable. Like, and on an IMAX screen, it's like, you know, you don't really see the edges of the screen, so it's like full immersive 3D. It was fucking awesome. Yeah, it was really
you got to cool. Come over and play Night Frisbee. It's just like, what do they call it?
Night Frisbee.
I've played Night Frisbee before. I used to go.
It's great.
To the South Coast. There's this beach there and they have a. You know, that material where you put it in the light and it's phosphorant. It's like a phosphorant, like, frisbee. So you shine a torch on it and it, like, glows for, like, 5 minutes.
It's like deep shit.
Yeah, yeah. And you need to play beach frisbee with that. I'd be up for some night frisbee. Fucking up.
Yeah, it's great.
Yeah.
It looks really cool.
Fuck yeah. All right, well, let's get into some of the topics that we've got going here. Got a few things to get through. looking at a couple of, like... Graham Hancock documentaries and stuff like that, which we've talked about previously on other podcasts, But you've been posting online some interesting shit. Now, how do you pronounce it? This is the Antikythera.
I say Antikythera.
Antikythera mechanism. Which what can you explain what you understand it to do?
It's either a navigating device or a device for predicting eclipses and planetary movements.
That's what I read about it. Is that it's I didn't. Yeah, well, I mean, if you can plot navigational ship by the stars, then you know by extension it would have been used for.
Well, it was found on a ship. It wasn't found on a sunken ship, so obviously it's got some sort of navigational use. I guess we didn't mention that it's 2100 years old or more.
This is the full-on thing, like the mechanisms and just the fact that it's got like, you know, gears and cogs in it, that predates by like 1,000 years when we thought people had that fucking technology, which is a fucking spin out, like, you know. And it's not like questioned that that's how old it is, like that's, it's like got carbon dating and shit on, because apparently it was in a wooden box that mechanism, and they managed to carbon date the wood that it was in, and fucking it's like 1,000 years before when we planted. So what does that mean? Like, was that one fluke occurrence that they managed to come up with that? Like, I was thinking about it, right? Is it possible that, ooh, sorry about that, that during that time of civilization, that you could have like pockets of ingenuity? So you would have like one specific tribe that figured heaps of shit out, like for whatever reason, they're like, you know, able to figure out things like the progression of the equinox, and like the, you know, the wobble in the earth and how that changes the stars above them and stuff like that. But that wasn't, they didn't have the ability to share that globally. So this one civilization's kind of sussed shit out, but then due to a cataclysmic event or whatever, they get taken out and their technology gets taken out with them. So it's not like, you know, the whole world had that technology. It could have just been one sort of, you know, pocket civilization that had that technology. And that might explain why you can find really old shit like that.
Well, it was interesting. It was found on a Roman ship. They think it came from nearby where it was sunk, which is between Crete and Antikythera, or whatever it is, the island.
Right.
Which is where Archimedes was from. So they think, you know, his school of thought may have had something to do with it.
Yeah, yeah. Archimedes, Greek?
Yep.
Yeah, yeah. I was reading about that and they were saying that even the carbon dating on that might even be off by like 50 or 100 years as well.
The device.
Yeah, yeah. So it's like, it makes you think, like, there's some theories, like, say that whole civilizations, like what we see around us today, this might have come up and fallen like maybe even a couple of times.
Yeah. Wouldn't there be evidence of that though?
That's what you start to think. Would there be fossil evidence?
All the people out there digging shit and, you know, building new shit to dig out this and build car parks and stuff, wouldn't they find remnants or
one of the counters I've heard to that, right?
Richard II. That's how they found his body, wasn't it?
Yeah. Wasn't he in like a car park underneath a car park or some shit?
They tracked him, did they? Right,
like some fucking ancient relic.
It was
in
London, and it was in a car park, and they radared it, and they realised it was some royal fucking dude, and it was in a fucking car park, man. Yeah. Like Jesus.
And they're finding that there's like
in London somewhere. Yeah.
Look, in terms of like, would there be any record of that stuff? One of the explanations I've heard why there wouldn't be is, when you have massive ice ages, like the ice sheets are like several kilometers thick and they just march across the land and like just grind everything underneath them, like whole buildings. Like there's these YouTube videos, right, where they're like, will it blend? And they get these hardcore blenders, right? Yeah. And they're like, will an iPhone blend? And they'll stick like an iPhone in these fucking hardcore blenders. And the things just, they turn to dust, man. Yeah. Like they just absolutely incinerate.
Gold dust.
And so that's just in a blender. What do you think, like a massive, like several thousand tons ice pushing across the face of a city, and look, it's just going to obliterate everything and grind everything down. I could
be talking out my ass, but like, if don't they do like mineral fucking samples and shit? And wouldn't there be minerals and stuff? Wouldn't there be like anomalies in these areas where it's like, holy shit, the minerals here are different to regular Earth? And then they'd be able to, you know, people are smart, they'd figure that shit out. I don't know.
I'm not saying I believe.
To grind it to go away absolutely, completely. So there's absolutely no evidence, even on a molecular or chemical level.
Yeah.
Is a pretty, it'd have to grind it for a fucking long time.
Yeah, yeah. Well, it's
I don't even know if that's possible, you know. It have to go somewhere. Like, you just can't make shit disappear.
Yeah.
Matter disappear. It's got to convert into something else. Yeah. I don't know.
No, definitely. That's
the questions that I raise.
The logical brain starts to think that, like, if there was, like, a fucking, you know, society that was this as advanced as we've become, surely we would be able to figure something out. We'd find something. And maybe these devices like this, what's it called again, Antikythera or whatever it is, device, is one of the few little things that we're finding. The other things that we're finding that I think are interesting that might point in just the possibilities of that being an option, like big civilizations existing that we didn't give credit for and being more advanced than what we thought. Some of the shit that's being found, like in the bottom of the ocean, like massive structures that they're finding at the moment.
Well, they found a new one in the Mediterranean the other day. Did you see that?
No, yeah. Which one's this?
I can't remember the name of it. It's apparently there's over 200 cities or areas that have remnants in the Mediterranean alone.
Full on.
Yeah.
Well, see, this is the other thing with the ice ages, right? So when the ice ages were
this one that we're in now, the southwest one, or the
no, we're talking like where the ice age was so hardcore, right? There was so much frozen sea ice that there was like 70-80% more land exposed on the Earth.
Right.
So that's where these cities that seem to be like, why are they in the middle of these fucking oceans? Well, fucking maybe 20, 30, 50,000 years ago, during I forget, it's a cycle, I think, of 72,000 years that the Earth goes through massive ice ages. So maybe 72,000 years ago, during the height of one of these big ice ages, there was like heaps more land, which is now considered the bottom of an ocean, where massive structures were built. And then the ice ages ended. And apparently these ice ages, when they end, they're pretty like abrupt. They happen like in terms of geological events.
Mm.
Like instead of like, you know, decades or hundreds of years, within like a few months, these like massive ice sheets are melting. Wow. And pouring water back into the fucking, you know, the system. And like 70-80% of the land now becomes ocean again. And there's, you know, that's why maybe we're finding these massive monolithic structures in the middle of the fucking depths of the oceans that we haven't been able to explore until recently. Like, it's only in the last few decades that we're getting these, like, you know, deep sea robots that are able to, like, have high def cameras and fucking sonar scanning ability and shit like that.
God bless you, James Cameron.
Yeah, fucking, have you seen any of the footage of him doing that
shit? He's changing his name to James Cousteau.
Man, it was pretty hardcore. Like, that thing that he went down in, like, the documentary where they show him, like...
The James Cameron shit.
Yeah.
Yeah, fucking...
He was part of the design team and shit, and, like, there was, like, heaps of times where all of the experts were like, man, we're so far off getting this right. He's like, fuck it. Put me in it, let's go down. Like, not in terms of down all the way, but like, he basically used himself as a crash test dummy in a lot of the development of it. Like, and then when they show the footage of him actually going down to the fucking Titanic, it's fucking hardcore, man. Like, man, it's, I don't know if I could do something like that. It was a tiny vessel, like.
It's creepy, it'd be creepy, wouldn't it?
Barely enough room for you to be in a chair and operating like some controls. And to get into that, you go like crawl through this full crawl space to get into the thing. Like, yeah, that I'd be claustrophobic just sitting in that device on land.
and then you drop that to the bottom of the fucking ocean. It's like, that's pretty hairy shit, man.
See those 8-meter sharks, serpents, and
but
leviathans.
Just on the topic as well of the whole civilizations resetting and stuff like that. The other compelling evidence that I've read about and heard other podcasts about, and it's interesting you brought up the, like, can't we examine the minerals and shit like that?
Mm.
When they actually examine a lot of the, like, soil, like, they go down and, like, the soil layers are like a timeline of what was going on during times. And all across the globe, when they go down to a certain level of the soil, there's these minerals and molecules that they find that are like, I forget what the term is, but it's basically like crystallized, like rock that shows a massive impact event. Right. And it's like all
vitrified rock.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Like it's like yeah, like only extreme high temperatures and high pressure environments create this.
So thermonuclear, is this what you're getting at?
Pretty much like a massive, like, we're not talking like one meteor, but maybe like a shower of meteors
hit
the Earth at this certain time. And it shows it all across the globe. Like, so this was like a global event. And so maybe that's the other theory about maybe civilizations being taken out by things like that. And that's why a lot of the pyramid structures align with the stars and things like that to be able to be like an indicator of when the next ones are going to happen. And a lot of them say that it's maybe like this asteroid belt that comes around every like several 10,000 years, and that these ancient civilizations figured out that this keeps happening. Fuck, man, we keep building up. But then we keep getting like drilled by this shit, and we got no way of like leaving our knowledge. So what can we do? Okay, let's build some kind of structure that might survive these massive events. So that's why all of these pyramids and massive structures were built around the world. And that's why they all point to stellar lineups, because that's there's a couple of reasons why they would do that. Number one, it's like a date stamp. Like, if you can line up the stars when this part of this structure would line up with those stars, you can figure out when we built this or when this date is significant. And that's one of the big things that a lot of people that question the date of the Giza pyramids and other pyramids around the world is because when you do that, they go back way further than when they officially said were built. And the other reason why they might have done that is that, you know, if everything gets destroyed, you know, who's going to know what language we're trying to talk to them in? You know, a language can die out really easily even when there's not a, like, cataclysmic event. So instead of, like, putting our message in words on the wall, why don't we build into the geometry of these structures how advanced we are? Like, because the fucking pyramids, man, like, the degree of fucking accuracy to make them is like, it belies what we think was the level of intelligence of people that built them. Like, so maybe they're like, mathematics and geometry are going to be the one constant universal language that's never going to change. You can't change mathematics. So how about we speak through our structures with how good we are at math and how well we understand the stars? That'll show them how advanced we were and maybe hand that knowledge on. And that shit will survive these massive cataclysmic events and be the one sort of, like, you know, way that we can pass on the knowledge. So, yeah, whenever I see those kind of fucking technologies, like that fucking device that can fucking predict, like, eclipses and shit like that, I'm like, that could be one of the last few remnants we have of those civilizations trying to tell us, like, you know.
Well, even if it only went as far as analog mechanics, it's a pretty amazing civilization to get to that.
Be able to figure that out.
That's the thing, man. Even if it was just what it is, just a fucking box that they could wind a hand crank on, even that's way more advanced as what we thought they could do then. Like, build a fucking little machine like that. To make a gear with teeth,
you know.
Exactly, yeah.
Metal or...
Have they found stuff earlier than that? Like, haven't they found stuff from like cavemen and stuff like that? Like, don't that they've written on walls.
I'll tell you what else they found, actually, I was going to bring up, was the Baghdad battery. Have you heard about that?
Is this the Ark? Some people say that this might be the Ark.
No. It's a battery, like an ancient power cell.
Right.
I think, because it came with a layer of copper and I think a tin rod or an iron rod.
Right.
And it was dipped in whatever solution and it made a little charge.
Oh, yeah, I know what you're talking about.
You could power a little, maybe a light globe or something like that. It was pretty amazing.
And there were theories that, like, maybe the pyramids, they had systems where they actually had lighting systems in the pyramid. Because, like, the fucking... If you go into the pyramids now, right, in Giza, the pyramids of Giza, and you turn off all of the lighting that they've rigged up, the modern lighting rigs that they've rigged up in all of the fucking... Even if it's, like, in the middle of the day, the sunniest day in Egypt, once you go into these, like, tombs and whatever they are, it's pitch black dark. You can't see shit. So do you think that even during the day... So maybe those Baghdad batteries were a primitive way of them having a lighting system. And they found heaps of them in the pyramids.
Well, not just... Even in... I think they found them in, you know, just normal abodes of...
Yeah, yeah, fucking no.
Baghdad abodes, you know, the little mud huts or whatever.
The public electricity system, yeah. Fucking Oz Energy. Sends a pot of shit around.
Interesting.
A couple of leads coming out. Yeah, I've heard also that same technology is what some people think might be the Ark, and that there's, like, the whole pyramids are actually some massive power generator, and this Ark is like gold-lined box that does the same thing with the Baghdad batteries, with, like, you know, some kind of shit inside it, and then that creates a current that they then take electricity out of. You put this thing in, like, the middle of the pyramids and it becomes this massive, like, you know, nuclear power plant, basically, for the whole of that area. That's a wacky theory.
You're getting kooky.
I've heard that. Break Spear is the one that's actually told me about that one.
Right. I've heard one that it's a big water pump. I've heard one that creates this harmonic that makes crops grow at a fantastic rate.
Oh, really? Yeah. That's a good one. I've heard that one. I like that one. It's a fucking accelerator for growth.
Magnetic crop acceleration.
Well, one of the things
a wacky fringe school of kooks.
How much effort would you go through to get your crops to grow a bit quicker? Like, you know, it would have to be marketably quicker. Otherwise, you'd be going, well...
Well, one of the mysteries...
200 years building this shit.
One of the mysteries of the Egyptian populace, from the records that we have, is that they were not a civilization that built up to their knowledge. They just came out of nowhere and they were as smart as we attribute. Even the scholars that, like, go to the traditional old school, this is how old Egypt is and this is how the pyramids were made, even they admit that when Egyptians came on to human history, they just arrived with this, like, full knowledge. They didn't develop the knowledge. They just knew how to do all this shit straight off the bat. And that's where a lot of ancient aliens, fucking George Tsoukopoulos, is that the Egyptians were mates with the aliens, and the aliens came down and gave them all these hot tips and, like, this.
Don't diss Georgios.
I don't know about that. I think that there might be more of a likelihood that what I was talking about before are these people that figured out how to pass on knowledge through these massive structures, through the mathematics that they use and the accuracy that they build them and the way that they align them with the stellar alignments. Maybe the Egyptians tapped into that, and that's how they had the knowledge so quickly, is that they learned how to take that passed on knowledge. That's one of the Graham Hancock theories that I think is...
Yeah, I've read a lot about the alignments and pyramids. I mean, they're all over the world, aren't they? They're in most continents, I think.
We watched that one ring. Went through, it's like the Aztecs did it, some dude in Southeast Asia did it, it was, you know, Northern Asia, like in China, they did it. Like Stonehenge, I think, was another one he pointed out. And then there's the pyramids.
There's even one in Polynesia.
Too much of a coincidence for all of these ancient cultures to be doing the same thing. You know, it's kind of like a common thread.
Very, very similar, yeah.
So there's questions. Nobody knows. Nobody knows. And it'd be interesting to find out. You need concrete evidence, of course. But yeah, that's definitely a question that was raised. It's like, how are all of these people that wouldn't even know that they each other existed all doing the same thing in their cultures at, you know, comparatively the same time? It's interesting.
It is. And there's a lot of weird political shit about it, like a lot of, especially in Egypt, like there's a lot of the official, you know, people that are like the gatekeepers of who can research more on the pyramids and fucking get access to, you know, there's apparently some chambers that they're like, a lot of the people that are like, these chambers, if we open them up, will tell us exactly the shit, we'll clear this shit up. And there's a lot of like the official Egyptian fucking authorities over there are like, no, we ain't opening that shit up. We just want to let, you know, sleeping dogs lie. So I think that's where it starts to become a weird political kind of situation.
Yeah, there's that tomb that they've sealed off. There's that little hole in the floor that was... Did you see that?
Yeah, there's...
It used to be open, they sealed it off.
They can only get into it via robot, apparently. Like, it's too small a chamber for a human to get in.
Yeah,
okay. And there was this funny hoax YouTube video, I remember, coming up to... what was the... Mayan date 2012, December 21st, 2012. Yeah. It was leading up to that, and they were I should bring it up. They basically fly to Egypt, and it's them filming themselves getting on a plane and flying to Egypt, and then they get off, and they're like all like, you know, looking dodgy as they get off the plane at Egypt, and they go straight to the pyramids of Giza, and they pull out their like knapsacks, and they've got like these remote control drones. It's like a car and like a copter drone, and they just drive them like into the pyramids, and they like drive up to what apparently is one of these chambers that no one's been allowed access to, and they're all like looking like this. It turned out to be a hoax, but it seemed like when you were watching the video that these guys managed to gain access to this restricted hallway with their drones, and it shows the drone just coming up to the thing and then going down the chute, and then the video ends, and it's like, this is a demand to like the Egyptian government, we will reveal what we found, you know, we don't want to show the public what we found, and here's the email address. It was like this like ransom demand to the Egyptian authorities of, yeah, we went in there and you know that you don't want us to show, and it turned out to be a hoax and shit, but like it was a pretty well done video, like
really,
you know, it wasn't like, oh, you know, it was, they were actually at the pyramids and shit, but yeah, it's pretty interesting subject. Yeah, I don't know if society necessarily got to the point where there was a bunch of dudes that had webcams that were doing podcasts with fucking microphones and looking at shit up on their tablets on their Wi-Fi. I don't know if technology got that developed in previous civilizations, but I do think that maybe caveman to us, that line that we're taught in history, I think that might be a little bit more jagged and a bit more convoluted than what is
a lot of assumptions led to made believe. In that as well, because nobody truly knows. You
That's
know?
Right. Yeah.
You know? Like, there is stuff that we do know, like we have found remnants of different types of, you know, body parts, and we know we came from apes and all that kind of stuff. Like, that's scientific fact. You know, they've found hard evidence.
Yeah. But
there's a lot of gaps in there. We're talking a lot of fucking time.
And there's a couple of other sexy key things. We won't stay on the subject too long, but I'm just remembering a couple of other sexy things that they found that support this whole more developed civilizations. The crystal skulls, have you heard about
that? Oh, yeah.
There's these crystal skulls that are found scattered around the world that, like, apparently, even modern technology today, if you tried to carve the kind of crystal that's in these skulls and make these skulls, it's impossible. I think that's what that Indiana Jones movie touches on.
Yeah, it was inspired by the real life skulls.
Yeah.
No way.
That's actually based off a real thing. Yeah. And these, some people have debunked the skulls. Some say, yeah, no, they're fakes. But I'm pretty sure one of the things that stands up about them is that we can't create them with our modern technology if we try to.
There's a lot of them too, apparently. There's like 13. And when you bring them all together, they'll solve the problems.
The other sexy thing that I think that I like to read about is a lot of that artifacts that are found from like these primitive cavemen, and they find like planes, like little model planes. And yeah. And they take these like little fucking carved wooden planes.
Was this in Ancient Aliens?
I think it might have been.
Yeah, the Mayan thing.
Don't know.
And they put them into like wind tunnels and shit, and the aerodynamics of them are fucking perfect, like almost better than fucking modern airplanes.
They and flew it. They made like a model about this big. You know, Giorgio's little badge that he's got.
Oh yeah.
That's it. That's the actual plane model, and they made it to scale, put servos and flaps and a prop on it, and it flew.
And
perfectly.
Apparently, like some detractors of that were saying, well, they were just copying birds. So just like, this is their crude estimation of a bird. But they found some that had like rudders, and yeah. Like no bird has a rudder. Like, and like that's a man-made technology, is a rudder.
With a tail and a rudder.
Yeah. And fucking can you imagine that? Again, I'm not saying that these guys got to the point where they were fucking doing podcasts, but what if they got to the point where they could travel between countries in planes? You know, just still, fucking, but able to fucking build a fucking craft that could go. That's crazy. It is like, crazy. That changes the whole fucking game.
I don't know if they have, but haven't they found like markings from that time, you know, and, you know, shit that they use to communicate to each other, you know? Wouldn't they communicate something that big? Yeah, if they're drawing on the walls with fucking, you know.
Yeah.
You know.
Well, it's lost technology. It's when you look at all the ancient Hindu or whatever it is, texts talking about the flying Vimana and the flying this and that and bombs of capabilities that seem like a freaking thermonuclear bomb.
Fully, yeah.
And like you said, there's areas, I think in India, where they've got vitrified glass, which is like rock that's just been melted into glass.
That's it, yeah, yeah.
And it's I think only a thermonuclear bomb can do that.
Yeah, yeah.
Or maybe a plasma shower.
Asteroidal impact, maybe.
Possibly.
But well, fucking,
this is good for comments as well. If guys have got comments or theories on this shit, let us know, because it's really interesting.
It does get into Ancient Aliens territory pretty quick. But it's a pretty cool topic.
Like, well, it doesn't necessarily go straight to the alien theory. It could be just human-made, technology that, as you said, catastrophic event, catastrophe.
All you need is massive meteor shower, an ice age. Like, even if you found fucking your iPhone in fucking 10,000 years from now, like, would you be able to boot it up? Would you be able to get any images off it?
No.
Would you be able to fucking not even know what it does? Like, you know, they're trying to insert it into their mind slot, and they're like, what did they do with this? Like, you know, so is that what we're like when we find these weird, like, you know, ancient cog fucking machines, and, you know, we just don't even understand, or hieroglyphics on the wall, or carved fucking planes and shit like that. Like, we're just assuming this level of knowledge, you know. If they found our shit, would they just think that we're dumb apes? Yeah, well, you know,
like, some things have taken us years to decipher, all the cuneiform or whatever you pronounce it.
I think that probably
cuneiform tablets and whatnot,
the closest thing that we've got to absolution of knowing this shit is probably the science of carbon dating. But the problem with a lot of like the structures and shit is they're stone, and you can't carbon date stone, so you need some kind of organic matter. And that's why they usually carbon date shit off like tools and stuff found in the local areas of fucking these structures. And sometimes that, like, you know, just because there some dude dropped a hammer there, are you going to call that building was built because of the only thing you can date off it is the fucking wood on that hammer, you know what I mean? Like, so that might be where a lot of fucking dating goes askew and shit like that. So, but yeah, it's a pretty cool topic. Like,
there's a lot of archaeology that's, you know, fringe underground stuff, you know.
And that's the thing, it's like, it's an institution, it's like a lot of people that get tenure and funding and shit like that, if you start to talk outside of what the fucking syllabus that's taught, you know, you start to question the boundaries of that. maybe you fucking don't get your fucking funding next year and shit like that. That starts to get into a bit more of a conspiratorial fucking, the man is out to fucking keep the knowledge down of, you know. And what, you know, I mean, why would they want to suppress that knowledge? Is, you know, if we could truly find out that there was fucking, you know, 4 or 5 different generations of civilizations that we didn't know about, does that make me fucking question everything and fucking burn down the fucking local fucking supermarket? They lied to us, fucking, I'm done, you know?
Depends on what.
It's weird why we can't question that shit sometimes, but anyway, talking about fucking stupid reactions and fucking people, a bit of a fucking running gag, I guess you'd call it, on our podcast. We've been following her since she came into the politics scene. Fucking Jacqui Lambie.
Oh, please.
And
isn't she gorgeous?
Oh, she's depends if her hair's up or not.
would you do Jacqui Lambie?
Would I do Jacqui Lambie? Is it, this seems to be a question you ask all your guests.
That's is the running gag.
Well, everyone has their price, no. Don't they?
No, I don't think I could.
I think we spoke about it on the last podcast how they were asking her about her love life on the radio, and she was she's like, yeah, I'm looking for a man, it's gotta be like, you know, rich and good package, you know, like quality. Now I accused her of being like a northern Queensland rough redneck, but she's a Tasmanian. She's a Tassie. I didn't realize that she's Tasmanian, which I guess is, you know, one for the other. You really, you know, they're both pretty rough. But, ooh.
Come on, man.
I've been kicking the table too. Sorry, viewers.
I got to admit, like, it was funny when we first saw her running for pup and some of those things that were coming out. And now, like, the latest. So, is she officially out of pup now?
She's independent now.
So, she's an independent senator?
Yeah.
So, you can do that, can you? I don't understand. Like, yeah. So you can run
under... She did the Xenophon.
What did Xenophon do? Was he with another party before he was independent?
Nationals.
Was he with the Nationals or Democrats or someone?
But somebody, and yeah, he got the shits and left.
That's a little strange that you can run.
But he's run a couple of times as an independent now since then.
That's okay. Yeah. Cool. Well, like, he's
kind of justified. I agree. I reckon it should go back up for a vote. And yeah, because she got, and this is what Clive Palmer's point is, I guess, is that she got elected under the pup banner, you know, as a pup candidate with the money and funding and backing of that, you know, and that agenda that they took, which, you know, what they're, if they actually had an agenda is debatable, but that's his point. And now that she's, you know, walked away, you know, I kind of agree that, you know, it should go back to the polls and then, you know, okay, well, you're not standing under those principles anymore. What are your principles? And put those up against other candidates and let people...
Well, it seemed like the big, big fucking, you know, thorn in her side was the Australian Defence Force funding cuts. That's where she started to get real, like, you know, nut, you know.
She's still nut.
And she's still nut. It's because she's ex-ADF, isn't she? So this was like an, you know, immovable topic for her. She was not going to accept it.
God, what did she do in the ADF?
I don't know. Do you know?
I think she was a soldier, man. I think she, you know, was in the front
line. Was a cook.
I don't know. Maybe, you never know.
Like Steven Seagal in Under Siege.
Seagull.
I found it's like an old fucking sketchbook, and I must have done it in like year 4. And it was like, make up a story and draw it and make it like a comic strip thing, you know?
What?
And I made it for Under Siege.
No way.
I copied Under Siege, and it was like, he fucking was a cook, and there was a chick in the cake.
The chick from Baywatch.
Yeah, and he threw the knives at the fucking chopping board for practice. Hit the bomb in the microwave.
Dude, you know your shit.
Put his head through the radar. I drew a picture of him putting his head through the
radar. I can't even recall these scenes myself. I don't think I've ever seen it.
Really? Man, not in all. Oh, it was my fucking...
Actually, speaking of quality shit and how you're into it, I brought you a present, Brewer.
Oh, no.
Before I forget.
Oh, what is it?
It's a backstage rocks it.
Oh, yes!
Because it all looks a lot better.
Oh, you're such a kind soul.
Backstage rocks it. Now you've got the paraphernalia to prove your allegiance.
I'm spewing, actually. I meant to bring you the crew shirt, but something's happened to it. I might have eBayed it for $1.
Oh, wow. Now you're dressed.
2012 World Tour, so it wasn't that long ago.
What was your involvement in this tour?
Logistics and production.
Right.
Etc.
Yeah, right.
Did you get to meet the stars?
No, I didn't. I didn't have them in my car, actually.
Right.
I didn't meet them, unfortunately. I saw them.
You saw them?
I saw them plenty.
Were they old and fat?
No, not really. They're older. She's having trouble moving, to be honest. She can't walk very well.
Are you serious?
Yeah. Poor thing. She had like a brain tumour.
Oh.
Full on. You can find all this on Wikipedia, I'm sure.
Yeah. Oh, shit. I didn't know that.
Yeah.
Okay.
So it's not really
that humorous. Brewer? Was she wearing shoes?
He's got to think about when he saw him. That she wasn't wearing shoes.
Really?
That annoyed him. Yeah.
It was, a lot of singers do that.
You pay a lot of money, you know, and you come out. It's not your lounge.
That's not classy, is it?
You know, it's like, that might be your thing.
It's animal.
No, thank you, man. That's a, you know, I wear that pride.
Look after it.
I'm very much dressed for success.
That's quality.
Yeah. Sorry about the shirt. I thought I had it.
Oh, so I think I'll live. I should have bought one when I went.
Oh, thank you very much for that. That's he's got a cabinet of memorabilia, I'm sure that's going to take.
Put it up in the cabinet. Yeah, that's right.
But yeah, talking about Jacqui Lambie and this whole, you know, I didn't realise that you could, go under the banner of one party and then just become independent senator.
Well, you could do it tomorrow, dude. You need 10,000 members in each state or whatever
to become an independent senator?
Well, I think that's for a party, isn't it? I'm not sure how the federal independent
members. A ridiculously small percentage of the vote, and it's like preferences and bullshit that she got fucking sent to and she's the person holding the country to ransom, and she's like represents a very small selection of the community. And that's what happens when you get like these very, very close elections. You know, you get these people. If, you know, either like if Labor was in control of the Senate, you know, like if they were in control of the Senate, she wouldn't even be fucking listened to. You wouldn't even know she was fucking there because she'd be irrelevant. Because it doesn't matter. Her vote doesn't matter. Mm. Doesn't matter what she votes for. You know, because she's just going to get fucking.
But because it's such a close election.
Because it's so close. And it's, you know, like, they need these people to get shit through because it's log jammed on each side.
Well, this is what brings up the next point I wanted to talk about, is that why does it become a close election? It's because the two-party preferred system is getting a bit old in the tooth for a lot of people. It's like, we're seeing this across a lot of democracies across the Western world that, you know, what was from 10, 15 years ago, pretty clear election results and now very, very close. And I see that as, and not only that, but the countries that have non-compulsory voting, like the US, who just had some midterm elections over there, the fucking turnout is the lowest ever.
Mm.
And I know just in the circle of people that I talk to that in the last federal election, there's a lot of apathy, you know, because fucking Labor fucked up for so long. But then look at what the alternative was. Tony Abbott, fucking massive fucking conservative cockhead. Like, people that are surprised at what Tony Abbott's been doing in the last fucking few times, whatever. Really? You're surprised? Now, what I am surprised is how bald-faced the lies are. Like, the promises that, you know, came out and that have just been broken one by one. That is pretty blatant. But if you're truly surprised, anyway, I digress. Two parties is just getting a bit old in the tooth for a lot of people. And So,
but it's
so does this not
can be more parties?
I know. And does this not create an environment for maybe an opportunity for us to break from this monotony of fucking going between these two dickheads for a third party, a viable third party?
Didn't we go down this road? And it's probably before my time. But with the Democrats or whatever, isn't that what that was supposed to be? You know, was that legitimate?
Yeah, we'll keep
party?
The bastards off.
That's a good point. The Democrats were one
and
of the
failed.
One
it
of the
failed.
They were one of the best hopes that there was for us. And look at how fucking bad that turned out. They basically turned into Labor, didn't they? They just basically.
Yeah, well, Kono went to Labor, didn't?
Yeah.
Got it on with Gareth Evans. Was that her?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure. Yeah. Again, it was before my time.
I'm wondering. It's the conspiratorial part of my brain kicking in, but
the illusion of choice.
Is this the best third party fucking possibilities that can be served up? Really? Like, look at the fucking amount of fucking energy people expend on complaining about how they're sick of the same old shit.
It's what they can serve up for now, dude, because I guarantee you within 5 years that woman will be on Dancing with the Stars or something like that. I guarantee you. I'll put it back. What's the date? What did we say? 30th of November,
fucking
2014. Earth, I reckon by 2019.
But here's the sad thing, and that actually beautifully dovetails into another point I wanted to talk about.
Dancing with the Stars.
I think you're referring to Pauline Hanson being on.
Well, there you go. I didn't even think of that subconsciously. I mean,
who's coming back to federal politics?
Yeah. I don't have an ego.
No shit.
But the party is me. That's what was on my table the other night. This is like, you dumb bitch.
Now,
I'm sorry, but she's a dumb fuck.
Again, it bolsters my point. This is the best third option we can serve up.
It's not.
This fucking racist, fucking, you know, uneducated, debasing fucking political party. Like, I remember One Nation. It was fucking a joke. Do you remember Pauline Pantsdown?
I was about to say. Yeah.
Fucking, it was an absolute national joke, man.
What about that?
He or she was on the same label.
The black rim glasses.
That's right.
And he had some fucking affair or some shit.
Oh, that
David Oldfield.
Yeah, that descended. Yeah. And then he came out with a tell-all book. Why do I want to fucking hear about you sleeping with... That is disgusting. Now she's pretty old, but even back then when she was considered like maybe younger. And,
oh, come on,
man. Oh, like even
did he really do the One Nation with him?
Yeah. It was a big part of their demise, I think. Because
I used to hear him a little bit on shitty. Yeah, I used to hear him a bit on shitty AM radio. 954 or
you watch. So you listen to AM radio, do you?
Oh yeah, definitely.
Yeah, fuck yeah.
I get through it anyway. Let's put it that way.
Do you listen to 702 at all? James Valentine.
Oh, preferably
Richard Glover.
Preferably
Richard Glover's
not.
Pretty good.
Richard Glover's alright.
What about that fucking the dumb bitch in the morning's pretty gay.
Look, it's 702. They do their own thing.
I like
whatever. I flick through them all. I flick through them all. I have a taste of all the shitty flavors of
that's
the ice cream parlor that is AM radio.
That's the only AM radio that I listen to.
I even go fully evil and go to 2GB.
Doesn't that have like crusty old ads?
The ads are annoying. They pierce your brain like a.
Oh. That's what I like about 702, no ads, and it just flows. It feels like you could go onto an ad, and it's like, you know, a sax fill, and it's back to fucking...
That's probably why I don't listen to them. I've always hated the sax segue, or middle 16.
AM radio, I don't know, there's something about it that's just like the limited bandwidth of it, the talk back.
It's not for music.
It's not for music. I don't know, it has like this old
It
man
can be very feel. Entertaining if you get the right callers on. And,
yeah, and like if they've got good sometimes the subject's pretty shit.
Entertaining is in you laughing at them.
Yeah, like, it's
that's 2GB is good for that. It's a real real so right of centre a lot of the time.
I went to bed at, I don't know, 2:30 last night and they had like overnights with some old fart on. And you know the people that call up, and that's probably a good segue as well. I was listening to Grandstand yesterday. Grandstand's a fucking good thing for AM radio. Grandstand is fucking awesome.
What's Grandstand?
Grandstand is like the sports coverage on AM radio.
Right, okay.
It's national, and they get all the fucking...
It's for blind people who can't watch it on TV.
But they get fucking proper fucking interviews, like with proper people, like, you know, like...
Really?
Like Darren Lehman was on, you know, talking and... Anyway, but they got people to call up and fucking leave messages about Phil Hughes, who, you know, tragically Phil
Hughes. Yeah, yeah.
And they were leaving messages and they played them back every hour with like a soft piano in the background. Ooh. And it's just like towards the end of the day, you can tell they were getting a bit, you know, it's a tragic thing, you know, and feel for him. Towards the end of the day, they were scraping the bottom of the barrel and this one lady called up and she's like, I didn't know Phil Hughes and I don't even really like cricket.
Oh.
But I'm shattered, and she was like,
with the piano,
sobbing playing. With the piano in the background.
I should not laugh. And God damn! Like, I'm not laughing at the tragedy. I'm laughing at the fucking ridiculousness that the AM, way that tragedy is played in the media. You know?
Sometimes they go a bit far with things, but
softly. You know, and it's like that's like the type of AM caller that you get, you know, and like. Some of them you do laugh at, you know. But yeah, yeah.
That's right. Okay, so we may as well talk about that now. The Phil Hughes thing, like that's.
I noticed the bat in the corner.
Messed up. We've got a homage going. Because like, I say to people, I don't really watch sport, but I watch cricket. Mm. Like, I'm not really into footy. I can watch, you know, AFL is probably, you know, again, I'm fucking ostracised from fucking living in Sydney by liking AFL over fucking rugby.
A lot better than it was,
but I love cricket, man. I've watched probably most tests that have been broadcast that Phil Hughes has played in, and fuck, man, like I remember fucking hearing about it, like I was at work and I was like, oh, and then there was like really grainy footage of it online, and it's like, because I think, was it only broadcast on
the web stream.
Cricket Australia site.
Cricket Australia website.
And I think that's the only footage I've seen played on the news reports.
Yeah.
But honestly, when I heard that it happened and he'd gone down, I'm like, oh shit, we've probably lost Hughesy for the fucking at least the first test.
Yeah, I thought.
That was my initial reaction.
I was like, man, you know, like, would have hurt, and you know, man, hope he's all right. But it was the last thing I was thinking about was that he died.
Yeah.
You know, and what a, you know, absolute, it's been said too many times, but it's a tragedy, and it's, you know, it's
fucking,
it is. Everyone's either played or had a game of cricket in the backyard or whatever. It is pretty full on.
And that's the thing, like, the guy that was bowling, is it Sean Abbott? Is that
Sean Abbott, yeah.
No relation.
Well, I don't think that he's like a like slow bowler, but he's certainly not the fastest bowler.
He's like medium fast at best. Yeah, you know. And it was a
so when you say playing in the backyard, it's not inconceivable that a backyard cricket game could probably have a similar delivery as what that guy bowled. You know,
it was top level, and it wouldn't be slow. Like, no. If any of us were facing him, we'd go, holy shit, that was fucking quick, man. Like, fucking hell. You know, but for, you know, for Phil Hughes, it would have been, you know, comfortable.
Well, that's the thing. Like, it seems like the shot that he selected that he got hit with was quite a, like, a big shot. It wasn't like, you know, it was a defensive shot that...
It was missed. He was playing
it. He was going for a big shot.
Oh, he was going for a big one, for sure.
And apparently it's just one of those, you know, the blood vessels that it hit was just a coincidence of the wrong amount of pressure in the wrong place in the head. And it was like instant aneurysm pretty much.
Mm-hmm.
And that's fucking fucked up, man. Like the fact that, you know, it was like a couple of steps and then to go, oh, and then just be down. Like, and then never regain consciousness from that point. Like, that's fucking pretty scary, man. Like,
and the other people on the field, like, it'd be so hard to go out and play cricket. And even anybody playing cricket would just think twice, you know? Like, if you're bowling a bouncer, for the next foreseeable future. Mm. It's just going to play on your mind. If you go to play a bouncer, it's going to play on your mind.
Do you think it would change cricket?
Well,
like that?
Asking the hard questions now. I don't think so. I don't think they'll ban the bouncer. I don't necessarily think they should.
No, they should. They won't.
They might look at improving the helmets somewhat. They might put a little flap of something. But you don't really want to gear someone up too much. You know, you don't want to restrict it.
Talking about it, again,
you lose a lot of heat.
And they're like, you know, the players at the moment complain about mobility with their head, being able to move it around, and also vision. And if you, you know, make that solid at the back there, you're not going to be able to move your head around.
Well, that's it. I was thinking you could have a flap hanging down, you know, some sort of padded flap. But
like a carbon fibre flap or something like
that. Yeah, but you lose a lot of heat through that area.
Yeah,
that might affect that.
Yeah, comfort.
Having this thing flapping around in the wind.
And you don't want to be, like, the other thing to remember is it's a freak accident, you know. It's like, this isn't going to happen every day of the week, you know. And it's like, it's so unfortunate that it's happened to, you know, such a, you know, young dude who's so much talent. But, like, you know, you don't want to be making knee-jerk reactions, like banning bouncers or, you know, saying you can't play a certain shot.
Well, yeah, it's bound to happen, isn't it? There's always your everyday...
But do you do nothing?
...garden variety knee-jerk reaction.
But do you do nothing? Like, if you were in the box seat, would you do something? Would you say to the cricket community, if you were in charge of cricket, if you were on the ICC board... Right, and you saw this, would you do anything? Would you feel the need to do anything?
No, I'd just tell everyone to be a bit more careful.
Yeah,
exactly.
You just have to show respect and remorse. And
it's body line anymore.
That's right. That's the thing. Like, I mean, why is it exciting as a viewer and probably even exciting as a player? I don't know if exciting is the right word. When a bouncer happens, a good bouncer, a good legal bouncer, it's because it has the potential to have personal injury. That's part of the, you know, you completely nerf any potential for any injury. Then you take away an element of, that's part of sport.
It's part of the skill of being a batsman is being able to
sacrifice the body is a term that I used to hear when I played cricket in high school, you know, more for fielding, you know, when you'd stop a, you know, boundary and stuff like that. But it's an unfortunate circumstance that this has happened, but the fact that an unfortunate circumstance has occurred is built in to the thrill of watching that shit go down, you know? And the fact that the odds have actually come home to roost, one in a million, just kind of proves that it is still got some lethality to it when you're watching it, and makes you go fucking, whoa, that bouncer man.
Well,
when I ask will change cricket, I don't know if it'll change cricket in the long term, but it's going to definitely change this summer of cricket. Think of someone like Mitchell Johnson, who not only is one of the kings of bouncers, but he fucking gets in the dude's faces. Yeah. And fucking, Australia's sledging abilities is to fucking make batsmen fucking a bit fearful about their good bowlers. So fucking Mitchell Johnson will fucking give you an eye. You know, is Mitchell Johnson going to be able to do that after fucking this? Like, fucking, you know, I'm going to fucking take you out.
It'd seem a bit insensitive, wouldn't it?
Walking back to his mark, and then fucking Haddon's like, mate, you better watch yourself here. You better keep your eye on the ball.
Get out of the way of the next one. Otherwise you get...
fucking head off, mate.
Yeah.
Warner coming up and fucking, you miss that one, can't. You know that's what they do when they're on the field. You know, that element's probably going to be certainly softened in this summer.
I think so.
Don't you think Warner looks like a lout? Like he'd just go up and glass a bitch?
I like how you glassed yourself when you said glass a bit. Glass a bit.
You would.
I don't know. Keep your eye on Candace or whatever.
Fucking Greg Bird and fucking Paul Gallen in a bar, and you got the three biggest grubs in Australian sport. Maybe Plastic Cup Ennis in there as well.
Yeah. Plastic cups, you reckon?
Man, you'd be the lads.
I think we'll see what happens. They won't ban the bouncer, no chance. Look at improving the helmet. I think that's the shocking thing. It's probably the one spot left in all the armory of cricket that's the Achilles heel, you know. It's the one spot, and it got show. He got exposed, basically. Yeah. So I think, you know, some little...
And, like, if he had played a different shot, timed it slightly differently, if he was a bit taller or a bit shorter...
Well, even if it hit him slightly to the left, that way...
You know, we would not even be sitting here talking about it. And that's what's so tragic about it, you know. And it's just like, poor dude, you know, doing what he loved, doing his job, and he dies, you know. And... You know, rest in peace, man, and hats off to everybody involved. Okay, put ourselves in the next question. We've got a test match starting next Thursday. We're scheduled the test to start on Thursday next week against India at the Gabba, right? The funeral for Phil Hughes is on Wednesday at his hometown, which is in
Maxville,
Maxville in New South Wales, right?
Remember country, Maxville, Barnsey?
Yeah.
Where is it? I've never been to Maxfield. What's up with Maxfield?
I think you stopped in a coach there. I'll tell you later. Anyway.
But yeah, okay, so pretty much the whole team, right? It's because he was New South Wales and went to South Australia. But he was New South Wales for a fucking long time. So Michael Clark, Steve Smith, Brad Haddon, Stark. Almost the whole team is going to be going to the funeral, right? So, and that's in fucking bumfuck Idaho, New South Wales, and they have to get to Queensland the following day to start a test match and switch on after being at a funeral for one of their best mates and switch on to, like you said, getting in their faces, because that's what we want to see. It's test cricket.
Mm.
It's, you know, you don't want it to be, you know, holding back.
This is you'll see a lot less sledging, a lot more focus.
But director. What's your call? Do you make him start on Thursday, or do you put it back? What do you do? It's a tough question.
If you can work it, it's all about logistics and.
Do you think it would be logistics state as well? Like,
well, what are you going to do? It's a professional game. There's so much money behind it. It's like, yeah, guys, like.
It's your job.
Shit's happened.
No, I agree.
It's already sold.
Agree. All that kind of stuff. But it is a tough ask, you know? Like, put yourselves in the player's shoes. Like, you know, would you be comfortable going out and being that intense we want in a test match?
I was thinking about it. What other sports have got that potential? Like, and there are a few. Like, I mean, Formula One, there's been, like, dudes that have been taken out and then... Next round, everyone's there and stuff. There's, like, you know, somber moments and stuff. But, you know.
That guy died last year.
Yeah, the guy got run over. Yeah, that was carnage, man.
So, like, I mean, it's done. I do think that they ended up giving him a day grace, didn't they, on the start of the test?
Well, I think they've said they're going to put it back by a day.
Yeah, I think that's fair enough. Mm-hmm. And, you know.
Get over the wake hangover.
I guess, like, you know, not to cheapen... The whole, you know, tragedy of it, but why not, like, turn it into, like, that classic, you know, Hollywood, you know, we're going up there and we're going to play for...
It is, and it'll probably be turned into the Phil Hughes test or something like that.
In a way, probably easier for them to deal with the shit by going out and playing a game of test cricket than fucking just being, like, you know... standing around at a wake or whatever.
I guess they have pretty much said it's up to the players. We have to talk to the players and see how they're feeling and see what their reactions are.
Yeah.
They might be exactly like that. No, fuck that, we want to go out in honor.
Just imagine, like, the test starts and India are just sledging hard, just like, you know, it's like every weekend they're like, kill it,
What would Hughesy think of that shot, huh?
It'll just be like then the headline the next day. That's one interesting thing I was talking to some people about. Is like, I don't know if the term is good, but it's probably better that this happened in a, like, Shield game, like Australians versus Australians. Can you imagine this happened
internationally
during the Indian test?
No, man.
And it was like one of the fucking Indian fast bowlers. Who's going to be the fastest Indian bowler this test?
I think they've got...
I
think it's Srinath. I think they had Srinath. And they got this dude with, like, the lion's mane hair. What's his name?
Just imagine it was like day two or day three of the test, right?
Bunting, like,
and heat. Day one, these, like... Phil Hughes and the fastest bowler in the Indian team like had some confrontation and they fully like you know, and it became this big media thing. And then on the second day before the test started, like the Indian dude's like, I'm gonna rip his fucking head off. I'm gonna rip his fucking head off. I'm not gonna hold back at all. And then the rest of the Indian team comes out and goes like, they apologize for his comments. And then he comes out and goes like, the team doesn't speak for me. I'm gonna rip his fucking head off. And they go out there.
What the and fuck fucking, are you on about? He thought this through.
And then he bowls and then he takes him out. Like, just imagine like what happened to him happens after some massive public sledging in the media of like, we're fucking, I'm gonna fucking take him out.
No, there'd you be know? None of that.
It would be none fucking of that. Hectic, man.
It would. You'd sent to jail.
Would you though? Think about it. Like, that's part of it. Like that Cricket Australia would be like, this is awesome. Look at what's going on. Social media is blowing awesome, up.
One of our players.
Not before he dies. Like on the day of the press conference when they're still like, you know, just sledging each other. They're just like, man, our ratings are going to go through the roof. Like there's been a tweeting that's happening on this subject. And then bang, it just goes bad. Like I'm just saying that it's probably a good thing that it happened. An Australian bowler bowling an Australian batsman, and this happening, or else there'd be like
that's
fucking
out of line.
No. Do you remember what happened last time India toured Australia? I'm pretty sure it was the last time India toured Australia, and Simons was still playing.
Is that how long ago?
I'm pretty sure. And Harbhajan came out with that touring squad. Do you don't remember?
No.
Called him a monkey.
Oh, the monkey thing.
Oh,
that was over there, wasn't it?
No, it was here. I thought it was over there. The Australian summer. It was definitely here, I remember. And I remember it clear as day. And it was in Australia. It was during the Australian summer. And we smashed them. Absolutely annihilated them. And then later on, that was when I'm pretty sure Steve Waugh took them over there. And it was like the first time we'd won in India for fucking ages. And like we'd done. Yeah, that was like the end of the golden era, pretty much.
So you're saying that Steve Waugh was playing the last time India toured Australia?
I'm pretty sure.
Wow, that's ages ago, man.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure we've toured India a couple of times.
Yeah, my memory serves me correctly, I think there's a controversy during that Indian tour where KFC were the sponsor, and they had this ad where it was one Aussie dude sitting in the Indian stand.
That was West Indies.
Was that West Indies?
West Indies, and he was like, yeah.
And he fucking
pulls out the fried chicken.
Of everybody being fucking super loud, so he fucking pulls out a bucket of chicken. Everyone's like, oh. And it was just quiet, and it was like, oh, that's fucking racist, man. Fucking black people fucking eating fried chicken. Yeah.
That's right.
Oh.
Well, I hope things don't come in threes as far as this cricket death thing goes, because number two happened yesterday.
What's the deal? Yeah, what's
it was apparently it was a Israeli umpire that was standing at the wicket, and the batter whacked it so hard that it hit the stumps and flew up and cracked him in the jaw. Broke his jaw or did something and he died from his injuries.
Holy shit. So he was like the, obviously at the other end on the stumps, umpire.
I think so, yeah.
Cracked straight down the pitch.
And it flew up, ricocheted off the stump somehow and hit him in the jaw.
So the ball ricocheted off the stump.
Ball ricocheted off.
Right.
And he died. I don't know how he died. It must have got him in a sweet spot.
Oh, like Husey. God.
And he apparently was an older guy who used to play for the national Israeli team. I didn't know they had one.
Cricket team, there you go. Fucking hell. Yeah.
Well, Afghanistan's got a cricket team. They play international
they
cricket.
They do, yeah. Mm-hmm.
They'll be here for the World Cup.
Yeah, think of like the Bodyline series back in like the 20s or whatever as well. Like the people had full, like they didn't wear helmets, man, and they were bowling this shit at them, you know. And well, like, they had broken jaws and shit, like fucking everywhere.
Oh, yeah.
People got hit in the head, you know, and like, you know, they would have fucked them up, you know.
Fucking
like, you know, it's so unlucky.
Are the bowlers of that era, I think we were talking about this the other night, are the bowlers of that era the same pace as
well,
what we
have
now?
Well, they think they were. You don't know. It's all anecdotal because you didn't have speed guns back then. Yeah. But, you know, like, they reckon if they had been able to get Lily, right, that would have been, you know, quicker than, you know, Brett Lee.
He probably was.
Show it back though.
I don't know about that, but you see some of the grainy image, man, and it's pretty fucking quick.
It's quick. You can
think about it. I mean, not much has changed, you know. A lot of those tall bowlers.
Yeah,
I think it'd be pretty similar.
But yeah, it's similar. I reckon. I don't think it'd be much slower.
It probably would be a bit slower, but not anything still major.
Fucking alright. Yeah. You know, like if anybody's played cricket, even if any of
I wouldn't Americans want to face
played baseball and been hit by baseball, you'd know how fucking hard it hurts. You know?
I wouldn't want to face Harold Larwood's freaking corpse, let alone when he was alive.
I remember I was at the Nets. Ages ago, and this is when I was working at Coles, and like, you know, I'm no fucking ponting, and me and my mate were there, and he's like, oh, I've got a mate coming over from Lane Cove. He works at Lane Cove in the meat department, right? And he comes over and he's like, oh yeah, Indian. And he's like, oh yeah, I had dinner with Tendulkar last week, and he's got fucking pictures on his phone with Tendulkar at his house and shit. I'm like, holy shit. He's like, oh yeah, I coach for New South Wales and I play for India for like a month, and he showed me all this shit on his phone, and I'm like, holy fuck, man, this dude plays for India. He's like, let me have a bite. And I'm like, are you fucking kidding me, man? You're gonna fucking kill me. So yeah, he bowled at me, and like, he's like, I'll take it easy, and he took it easy. He reckons he took it easy, and man, it was just like, you got no time. It's like, holy, you just like, I'm done.
Yeah, right.
I can't do this. This is impossible. You can't bring your back down quick enough. You can't. You don't have time to be able to fucking decide front or back foot. It's just, it's impossible, man. He wasn't even going full pelt. And like, I can only imagine a Johnson coming at you at 150 k's with those eyes slinging it at your head. Like, fucking hell.
So this guy only played a short time. I guess it's pretty competitive.
Yeah, and you think about it. Billion people are in India as well. Like,
and they all play.
And you got no idea what it'd be like to fucking face that full pace of those modern fucking bowlers. Like,
it's ridiculous.
You watch the slow-mo of the modern batsmen, and they have to like they do this thing where they have to like just at the moment where the ball comes out of their hand, consider that they're timing it where they're like, so they're not blinking. I think that's to force no blink during the time that the ball comes out of the hand, it bounces and you hit it. So they have to be like that, and then it's like, because yeah, it's blink, miss it. Like, and how do you pick? Like, and I guess that's where a good, like, seam bowler can, you know, trick a batsman with, you know, the movement of seam. But how do you watch that? Like, just the fact that you, like, I remember facing some of those bowlers in the brief stint that we played competitive cricket recently. Mm. Like, you'd just be thankful to the Lord that you'd hear the ball hit your bat sometimes. Yeah. You're just connected with it. It's like, let alone shot selection and being able to pick out, you know, parts of the field. It was like, it's fucking hard, man. Like,
and then if that hits you, it's like, holy shit.
Jezza, did you have any topics you wanted to throw into the mix while I look at my list?
Oh, what? We're talking about Ferguson, weren't we?
Oh, fucking man. I've got a great little thing about that I want to talk about. You know when sometimes, like, you're looking at a situation and it's like, you know, you kind of look at things through a certain prism, right? And then somebody tells you something or you read something and it kind of, like, just doesn't change the way you look at something, but gives you a different angle on something you never really considered. It just makes you look at each subsequent time that it happens with a slightly different mindfulness. Well, Ferguson, right? The story there is that the cop shot the kid. It was like, apparently the protester's story was that he had his hands up and he was saying, don't shoot, and the cop shot him. The cop's version, and what is now turning out to be more witness events coming forward, is that this kid actually charged at the cops, and that's why the cop shot him, like, you know, ran at the cops.
Right.
Either way, it looks like the way that the, you know, police department has handled it has been shit as always, and, you know, that's made this town Ferguson.
Grand jury bullshit, man. Like, it was like, I saw the end of it, so I'm not too versed on it, but from what I saw, this grand jury bullshit was a bit fucking dodgy. Like, that was, like, appointed by the fucking government. these people.
Like handpicked,
you know,
or something?
Yeah, handpicked. Yeah, okay. It's like, you know, like 3 black people and 7 white people or some right. shit. And they would have been screened and told what to do before they went in. I think that's what the allegations are. And that seemed a bit fishy to me.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, and yeah. I saw the press release before they started lighting cars on fire and shit, and they fucking he was like, look, like, and like you said, a lot of the witness stuff that I heard, they came and changed their story to either, you know, say that he was charging or they changed their story, you know, or some of it was just flat out disproven.
Right.
So, and he laid it out pretty concisely in this press conference.
Yeah, yeah.
In those points, I was like, all right, I can see that. But still, it's fishy. And, you know, like, no charges, like, nothing to happen out of it.
But basically, one of the net effects of all of this going down is that the town has just rioted. Like, you know, it started off as protests, but it very quickly descended into fucking, like, looting shops,
lighting cars on fire,
throwing cars over on their side, fucking
the usual rioting shit,
pretty hardcore shit. And yeah, it is the usual rioting shit. And I used to always look at that and be like, man, like, it's almost as if there's this subset of people just waiting for fucking unrest. It's like, right, I'm going out and I'm getting me some looting done, you know. And I used to always sort of think, you know, what is that fucking doing? You're just fucking kind of, you know, giving more reason for the fucking hammer to come down on you, for them to fucking declare martial law, or to fucking, you know, use the anti-riot police fucking squad in those tactics. And I just always think, you know, it's silly. But there's one angle that I find interesting in, I can't remember who I heard saying it online, but they were going, okay, the reason why people riot, and the reason why people fucking break shit and fucking, you know, do this antisocial behavior, isn't so much as that they're just waiting for this shit to go bad and then they can fuck shit up. Is that they live with this shit not being recognized for so long. Like, they live in, like, fucking police brutality and fucking, you know, inequality in, like, search and seizure and fucking basically getting hassled by the police and people getting shot and not fucking actually getting any national exposure from it, and all these, like, you know, corruption in the police force, that when it finally, when a story finally does break through, they're like, as a, like, pushback against all of that bullshit that they've fucking had to deal with up until that point, that's why they riot. It's like, it's the one time that they get to sort of, like, have an exclamation point of, this shit happens all the time and it's fucked. Now, I don't think that justifies it at all, but it's just it's an interesting, like, light that gets shed on it for me when I see these people. Like, it's not just, fuck it, we're going to go out and fucking rob that store. It's like, man, we've been fucked over so much for so long that this is our chance to sort of push back and balance the scales a little bit. And it's the same with a lot of things. There's a lot of people that come out against a fucking cause. They might seem super extreme and fucking stupid in what they're saying, but it's not so much that they want to go as far as they're saying they want to go. It's just they're trying to be a counterbalance to the fucking amount of bullshit that seems to push back at them all the time. And then maybe if they're super extreme with what they demand, the meeting in the middle will be more realistic. You know, does that make any sense? Like, yeah, it doesn't justify shit.
It's all about compromise.
Half of these people are still fucking idiots for going out and trying to steal a fucking...
Well, I was going to say, you've always got that tip rat element.
Oh, totally.
There's always the tip rat that'll take advantage.
I always think of fucking The Simpsons, where, like, all it takes is Mo just to shout out, like, let's fucking go get him, and the whole mob's just behind him, like that. Like, they just turn, like, you know, mob mentality.
He brings his piece of love. He brings his piece of love.
He breaks his legs. Fucking, and it does kind of, like, it's disappointing for me to see sometimes, because, like, all of these fucking police departments that get these stupid budgets for, like, riot gear and fucking, you know, fucking pepper sprays and fucking stupid fucking full body armor and shit. It's when those riots happen that then they can go back to their departments and go, see, we need this shit. We need this more and more. And then what happens is that sometimes like more traditional protests where you got fucking people just, you know, expressing a democratic right to convene and, you know, share opinion, all of a sudden the fucking riot police are there, like, from the get-go, because they've got all this gear and this fucking budget, like, they're not going to fucking, you know, sit back. Like, it might just be fucking some fucking, you know, vegans for fucking free vegetables meeting down the road, and they fucking, they send all the riot police in because they've got this massive fucking tank sitting in the fucking, you know, so
yeah,
sometimes I wonder if fucking rioting is, like, it's super counteractive to fucking getting, like, you know, shit changed. Like, it's just shows that you fucking just need to be controlled.
But, unless it's a really extreme situation, but that's another topic anyway. There was another shooting I was going to mention. Did you see the 12-year-old in
with
Ohio?
With a toy gun.
Yeah, I did.
He was walking around shooting. I mean, would you walk around pointing a gun? Isn't it drilled into people's heads in that country that you shouldn't really do stupid things like that in front of stupid police?
True.
I think he got up. The police approach was all wrong. You know, they pulled up next to him.
Probably, result of the gun culture is that, you know, that's, you know, they instantly think it's a real gun.
Well, that's
and they
it.
Probably have good cause to think it's an actual real gun.
Probably
because most of the time
that.
It probably is a fucking real gun, you know.
Yeah, he might have been an older looking kid, but I think he point for it's one of those stock motion footage.
Yeah, there's very choppy video.
So it's hard to tell if he points it at the police or not, but they just come up and they come up sideways. Like, I'm no police expert or anything, but I think I've watched enough TJ Hooker to work out that they should have pulled up straight up to him, you know, and used the door as the shield.
Fucking oath. Well, I mean, yeah, there's a couple of things to say about that. Firstly, I've seen the footage and it does seem, I mean, silly that you pull right up next to a dude and just get out of your car and just bang. Like, why not pull up a bit
back. Yeah.
Don't you have some kind of announcement speaker on that thing? Like, you know, put down the weapon.
TJ Hooker had to.
Fucking knows. Like, we've seen so many fucking TV shows and movies.
They should make them watch TJ Hooker in the Police Academy.
You know what other movie comes to mind, though?
It's Police Academy.
Original Die Hard. And there's that scene where they're, like, you know, swapping stories. I think it's where John McClane's pulling the glass out of his feet. He's like, how'd you end up behind a desk? And he tells the story about there's this kid, it was dark, it was a plastic ray gun, I thought it was a real gun, I shot it. And it's like, you know, so, you know, that story's as old as Die Hard, you know, that some kid playing with a ray gun. And it is a shame that in America, I guess that's part of, you know, the nest that they've made, that they roost in, is if everyone's got guns, the cops have just got to basically treat every fucking thing that they respond to as the potential of
There's guns
going to be on the scene, you know, like, but the way that car pulls up, yes, it's choppy video, but it just looks like they were like, there he is, Nin! Bang! Like, just got out of the car and just iced this kid, like, and the kid was probably like, you know, and the footage is like, there's a good, like, 5 minutes of the kid just playing by himself in the park before the car rocks up, and the footage that I've seen, he's just wandering around and I'm trying to actually see him hold a gun-shaped thing up. I can't really see it in the video.
There's a couple of bits where you can see the the point, but yeah, definitely a gun-shaped object.
But that's messed up. I think that the true solution to all of fucking those situations is GoPros on every chest of every cop. Like, come on, like, it's you fucking got the budget to buy your tanks and your riot gear, please. I'm pretty sure that a couple of, like, $150 GoPro
technology's so cheap now.
And then I was reading an article where it's really easy for them to lock those kinds of technology down, where they can't be tampered with, only, you know, and if they are tampered with, like, make it massive, like, fucking penalties for cops. Like, just like every other fucking, like, if you're fucking a retail clerk and you were, like, in a high cash volume environment and you had cameras on you and you were found that you were tampering the fucking footage of those cameras, you'd be fucking in deep shit. And, like, why wouldn't a cop have that same fucking, you know, requirement? You know, they're walking around with fucking cannons, you know, and tasers and shit. And all of the cops in America that have done that, because there's some states that have got it mandated now where they have cops with cameras on them, man, the amount of fucking brutality just plummets.
Wow.
The amount of complaints against the police, it's like 80% drops in complaints against police because fucking they've got a camera on them. They, you know, all this ambiguity that we're talking about with these cases with Ferguson and this choppy video and this kid. Would, like, if it was a high def fucking, you could see straight away, you know.
The ball's rolling. There's a lot of people talking about it.
Getting cameras on cops.
Wanting cameras on cops.
It's got to be done, man. And some of the, you know, some of them have come out and say, oh, the budget. It's like, come on, man, look at the budget you're spending now. I think that this will save you money in the long term. It'll save fucking, you know, court cases and fucking liability cases and... Yeah, I can't believe it's even being debated, you know, that fucking... You're a government employee. Of course you should have a fucking camera on you. Like, come on, it's a moot point, you know? But, yeah.
Going to the bathroom would be a bit embarrassing. You have to cover it up.
What else have we got here? You got anything else on your list there?
No, I think we've covered it.
I've got just a couple of other quick things I want to talk about. Just a couple of funny things. I've been noticing, like, I always think of, I'm a big fan of Bill Hicks, and Bill Hicks's comedy is now, like, you know, 20 plus years old, but it's always amazing how many things that he talked about back in the day, like, that were, like, these, meant to be these wild, like, and can you imagine if society started doing this kind of jokes? I always like to kind of, you know, keep track of how close we're getting to those predictions that he made. And he's got, he had this funny routine where, you know, if advertisers were allowed to, you know, they had no restrictions in terms of like using sex and stuff in their ads, it'd just be like all out. Like it'd just be like pornography on advertisements, all right? And Bill Hicks used to make a joke of like, you know, if Coke could make this ad, this would be the next ad you would see for Coke. You would just see this like, woman's face in frame, like beautiful, gorgeous woman, and the camera starts panning out, and it's like, you know, she's naked, you know, topless, like you see this perfect body, perfect breast. Camera keeps panning out, and it's like, you know, she's completely naked, but just right in front of her, you know, vagina is just like a bottle of Coke, and it just like fades to black. It's just like, drink Coke. Right, and I saw this fucking Coke ad that's like, it's admittedly a, like a European Coke ad, but it's essentially that. It's just like this woman sitting on the ground naked with her legs spread, and just right in front is this bottle of Coke. And like, that's a pretty extreme example, right? But there are drink Mount Evian
Coke water.
It is, it's owned by Coke.
It is, yeah. Fucking right.
That it is.
They got Jennifer Hawkins as their Maddie.
Really?
Really?
Like that.
Like now, then she should Maddie. Do them this ad.
Yeah, definitely.
But there's, I find other subtle ways, like that other advertisers, like they're always trying to like push the boundary in terms of, you know, how much sex they can show in ads. But one point that I want to bring up is like these like fashion labels. That are like so, the names of their labels are just so close to like swear words. It's like, why don't you just make it a swear word?
Like the FCUK.
FCUK. I see that everywhere. And I know that it's an acronym for something else.
Is it? I don't either. I see it as
some fun. Dude's name is the FC and UK is the United Kingdom, apparently. But come on, who are you fucking kidding? You see some like hot chick walking down the street with FCUK in big letters. I'm not thinking of an acronym in the country of the United Kingdom.
You know what I don't get, man? There's one fucking clothing store that I just don't get. Super dry. Why do you want shit to be super dry? And why do you want to... It's like, why? I don't
know. Like Dries-a-Bone gear?
No, it's a shop. They're a chain of shops called Super Dry. And they've got their own brand of shirts.
Thought it was a beer.
Yeah. Like, what the fuck... Regular dry isn't good enough. Super it needs dry. To be super dry. And I saw another one, and you see something like, I think Djokovic wears them. and I've seen some of the golf players wear them, and it's UNI OLD or some shit. I thought it was University of Queensland, to be honest. But it's like, and I saw some fucking big fucking banner in the city, and it's some old chick like, hey, laughing with some regular fucking blouse or something. And it's like from Tokyo to Sydney. And I'm like,
a nice floral number.
Why? No, it was just a plain navy fucking thing, and she's like, hey, like laughing. And I just don't understand, like,
fashion
why,
is
why does that make people go and buy that shit, you know? Like, is it because Djokovic wears it and then they see a billboard for it and they can go and buy it? Or is it that billboard and they go, oh, that's a good ad, I'm gonna go and buy it? Or I don't understand, like, what's super dry? I've been to this super, it's big letters, it was like fucking Wham shirts and shit, you know? It's like, eh, it looks okay, it's nothing special. And like, what's this
Wham super shirts.
Dry shit?
What, Choose Life or something?
Yeah, that's right. Like, it's, fuck, I don't
Wake
understand.
Me up.
I just don't understand. Like, see, some of these shops are fucking massive. You know that fully new fucking Tang place near Broadway with all the flowers and shit all over it? There's one at the bottom of that.
Yeah.
I used to go past it every day. Packed and massive. And it's super dry. I just don't get it.
Well, I think that when you question why with the billboards and why, like, basically it's working exactly how it's meant to, it's just that its net effect on you doesn't quite work the way that they intended. But see how you're like I don't get it, I see it just like on billboards, and it's just this, like, you know, that whole curiosity is their whole advertising right. angle, and to get people is like, I see this everywhere, and I need to be in the in club knowing about this stuff.
Shouldn't it be like, oh, I like the style of their clothing?
Well, that's not enough, because that becomes quite a shallow pool of variety, because there's only like a few truly good styles, and that's where the term fashion comes in, because clothes, there's like, you know, you see when they try to make some fucking innovative clothes and these catwalks with these fucking ridiculous things that no one's ever going to wear. Some dude with some lycra fucking, you know, headgear and, you know, all these stupid fucking fashion items.
Yeah,
you see.
Your man.
The thing is that, you know, the t-shirt, the shorts, the pants, the jeans, that's what fashion always comes back to, or what just good design usually comes back to. But fashion needs to make a play on that, so they have to create a mystique and a fucking sense of belonging to a tribe. And this fucking, and good on you for looking at that and going, you know what, that shit just pissed me off, I don't want to have
that's
any
like
part
pop
of it.
Music. It's
throwaway crap. It's creating intrigue, and you want to fucking be part of the intrigue.
I can understand, you know, like putting it on a sports person, because I'm going to watch that sports person and I'm like, might look at those clothes he's wearing and go, fuck, I don't mind the shirt he's wearing.
Yeah.
Where can I get one of those? Oh, it's one of those brands. I'll go. That kind of makes sense to me. You
were,
know?
Were you into hypercolor?
I was very much. I was fully. Oh, man, I found when I was moving all my old basketball cards, I was fully into basketball with the fucking air pumps, Reebok pumps. And like, that was, you know, purely about how they looked, and they had the pump thing in them, you know, it wasn't, and all the people on the cards and shit wore them, you know, and that's the reason why I used to get it. It wasn't, I don't know, it's weird.
I had a hypercolor, but I found that they fucking stopped working pretty quick. Like,
yeah,
they survived a few washes.
I think we tried to wear them in like the ocean, and that fucks up.
But yeah, fashion fucking, I just find it funny, like FCUK, like just call it fuck. And there's this other brand that I saw, is like Pop Cherry. I'm like, really? What am I meant to think of when I see Pop Cherry?
You know what else gives me the shits? Some of the names of these Asian bubble tea places. Happy Lemon. What the fuck?
Just go with it, brother.
Lemon. Easy way.
Just go
like,
with it.
Is there a hard way?
The easy way. All right, let's call it. So yeah, thanks everyone for tuning in for the podcast again. Thank you to Jezza for joining us.
Yeah,
for,
thanks, man.
For episode 8.
Pleasure, treasure. I'll be back.
Always, the podcast is now available on audio format. So we're on iTunes, we're on Stitcher, We're on Windows Marketplace, all of those usual ones. We'll put links underneath the video for the audio tunes, audio versions. We'll be doing more casts here from the new studio over the next couple of weeks. In fact, we'll probably keep up the tradition with the birthday podcast, so that's probably coming up pretty soon. So, yeah, thanks for tuning in, everyone. Talk soon.
Yeah, peace out.
Adios.